Maryland who would deliver babies instead of us having the shortage we have today.
All right, let me come back to the economy for a minute. We've been seeing in the news all of the trouble with foreclosures, and I'll start with Mr. Wargotz on this one and start with you on the next one. Is there anything Congress should be doing to put the housing crisis as a whole behind us?
Behind us. It's a huge problem. Over 200,000 foreclosures in Maryland. I mean, it's a huge issue of which our federal representatives were slow to the go on. I mean, a lot of the votes and policies that our senators have taken, supported the practices and modified practices of Fannie and Freddie and helped get us in the mess where we are today. We can't keep sending the same people back when they're digging us in this hole and not helping us get out.
Senator?
Well, first of all, I'd like to stop this terrible confusion around the foreclosure mess right now. Is a house in foreclosure, the whole screw up on that? So number one, I would be for a mortgage foreclosure moratorium till we got straightened out who actually has title of a house. Second, and continue to encourage the purchase of a home through those Obama tax credits of giving $8,500 to buy a home if you're the first-time owner, and $6,000 if you're buying it. It could be the second time you're going to buy a house, not for a second home. And number three, also to get rid of the mortgage scams. Because of the committees I chair, I encouraged and put money in the federal checkbook for the FBI to come in to get these wheelers and dealers that were involved in these mortgage scams that put people into houses that they couldn't afford at faulty and flawed mortgages with all kinds of balloon payments that have caused this. And then the third, one of the reasons people are in foreclosure is because they've lost their job. And I'll come back to one of the main things Congress needs to be doing is promoting jobs in the private sector.
But we haven't seen that happen. We've seen them promote them in the government sector. Every time we pass a new bill, like the health care law, we create new bureaucracy and new government. And we're not creating the environment where private enterprise can thrive through tax cuts, through avoiding the tax increases we're going to see January 1st, creating the environment both in the business arena as well as in the home arena. Every family can benefit from those tax cuts. Everyone unemployed benefits from those tax cuts, because what happens is businesses can then hire more and consider producing additional inventory, and then there's people who can fill those positions. Right now, we're not doing that in Maryland. We've got the same approaches, tax more, And government's the solution, and government is not the solution.
Senator, do you want to finish up on this or go to something else?
Well, I believe that there are certain things that government does need to do. For example, I've consistently fought for money to dredge the Baltimore Harbor so that the big ships can come in and create jobs on our docks. We now have, and I believe in public-private partnerships. So I'm advocating and actually putting money in the federal checkbook to dredge our harbor for the new ships that are going to come through the new big Panama Canal. Governor O'Malley has worked with something called Ports of America, the private sector. So between the private sector coming in to modernize our docks, Team Maryland, the congressional delegation working together, getting the bay dredged so that these big ships can come in. These are thousands of jobs in our port. Federal funding, yes, generating private sector jobs down on the docks.
Well, the port is a nice transition to what I was going to ask next, and we'll start with you on this. You may have seen the pictures in the news of that last house on Holland Island in the Chesapeake Bay that finally slipped beneath the waves. It's been a long-term process, but to what degree and by what means should Congress, if at all, deal with climate change?
Well, first of all, I felt so bad for that family. And it was an 80-year-old man, and he fought so hard. But the bay has its life cycles. But yes, I do believe that there is climate change, and that climate change is man-made, and that it's being induced. For example, we get acid rain and acid snow here from the coal-fired plants of the Midwest. And the best way to deal with it, and it's also a national security issue, is to get America off of fossil fuels and more into clean energy, new jobs and alternative sources, using more natural gas, and also going nuclear if where it's appropriate and where it can be guaranteed as safe. And that also does mean putting a price on carbon. So we need to have the right legislation and the right regulation, but I believe it'll generate jobs in the private sector and also keep us from funding these petro-jihadists, you know, that want to kill us. Every time we're dependent on oil, every time we fill up a tank, we're filling up a terrorist gun. I want us off of that. I want the climate better, but I want America safer.
I would say that what's been proposed up to this point has been nothing but additional tax, additional economic stress on individuals and companies. And yes, we need to do more with our fossil fuels. We need to be more efficient with them. And of course, we need to cut down on pollutants into the environment every chance we can get. But I haven't seen the leadership in the Senate talking about this over the past 34 years. Up on Capitol Hill, 24 years here, 10 years in the House. I mean, where is the leadership on these issues? Where is the leadership on creating the jobs for Maryland? We're still behind. We're still in a hole.
Well, I like to talk about the jobs of the future, and I see the jobs of the future in Maryland in the field of technology. We have federal labs that will leverage private sector jobs, one of which is because we have the National Institutes of Health, which I think we would both agree is a crown jewel in our country. But that also spawns a vibrant biotech industry. It's growing in Baltimore. It's growing in the Route 270 corridor. There are 75 biotech companies in Frederick. We see the future there. And also in cybersecurity. We have the National Security Agency in Maryland. We are in a third war, Iraq, Afghanistan, but the cyber war, where we're being attacked by Russia, China, and organized crime. We can develop, and we are developing, the cyber shield here in Maryland. These will be private sector jobs working with our government, and that's estimated to be another 15,000 jobs over the next 4 or 5 years.
Well, we've heard this time and time again, the same old rhetoric about how we're going to create jobs, but yet we don't create jobs. In Maryland, our unemployment rate just went up last month again to 7.5%. What we need are fresh ideas. I understand the medical arena. It's true. We do have a lot of opportunities in Maryland with biotechnology and public-private partnerships through the NIH, and that's wonderful. But that's not the end all. We've got people who can't find jobs in Maryland, and we're not doing enough about it.
Talk to me about campaigning in this environment. We read polls and see what voters are saying, and there's this perceived enthusiasm gap between the parties. Talk about your encounters with voters and what they're telling you.
Well, I've been, obviously I'm not an incumbent. I'm a county commissioner, first term. It's been very exciting for us. It's been a family adventure. But it's also very serious. These are very serious times. And as I go around from state, you know, from county to county, I run into folks, regardless of party, whether they're Democrat, Republican, or unaffiliated, who have had it. They've either had it because they don't have jobs, or they're threatened to lose their job, or they know people who can't make their mortgages. They see the ads from the senior senator talking about the jobs that she's brought here, and they're wondering, where is she? What's going on? We don't see that on the ground. We lose the solar energy plant in Western Maryland. Bethlehem Steel closes. Silo Cup factory closing, the GM jobs. I mean, these are all serious, and these all more or less, most of them have occurred before the stimulus package ever came. So where was the help then? And so I have to say, you know, we can't keep sending the same people with the same ideas back. We need fresh ideas, and that's what I bring to the table.
Senator, what are you hearing from voters this year?
Well, I hear a lot of anxiety. many people talk about anger, but I think it's more anxiety. They wonder, are they, we're going to continue to have a middle class in this country? Is the middle class slipping away into something that was once part of a forgotten American dream? And they want people who get them, not the big macro issues. They want us to understand the macaroni and cheese issues. That's why I come back to what I said at the beginning. Whether I've been at the work site or whether at a round table, they really want a job that they think is going to stay in the United States of America. The kinds of jobs that I'm talking about, both we've created and are going to continue to be created, will stay here. The Port of Baltimore is not going to go away. The fact that we have the National Institutes of Health and Biotech is not going to go away. The second thing is they want to have a safety net for seniors. Old people are really worried that the new crowd coming in is going to privatize Social Security and turn Medicare into a voucher program. And I promised them I would chain myself to my chair in the Senate rather than go for the privatization of Social Security or turning Medicare into a voucher program.
You're next. I have about 45 seconds for some sort of summary.
Well, whatever I would just say that as a physician, as a patient, as someone who's been in medical strategic planning, the senior senator voted to cut Medicare. That hurts seniors. She voted essentially for a government rationing health care program. That is horrible for America. That is why we have to repeal it. You know, what I bring to the table here are fresh ideas. It's not the same old, same old. It's a different perspective from the entrenched incumbency of folks who tend to think more about their political future than they do about the folks who got them elected. And that's a major concern of mine in Marylanders across the state.
Senator, about 45 seconds.
I'm not a slogan senator. I'm a solution senator. And again, those best ideas come from the people. When I walked Frederick Road and walked into a baker shop that heard sound, smelled so much like my grandmother's, I thought, wow, do I want to help Ned expand? And I want to help small business. That's why I went back and fought the ability for small business to borrow, tax credits for their health care, tax credits to expand. That's what I do. I listen to the people, and then I go back to try to help them be able to help themselves. That's the kind of senator I've been. That's the kind of senator I'm going to keep on being.
Well, I'd like to thank both candidates for joining us here at MPT for this joint appearance. Senator Mikulski, Dr. Wargotz, thank you for your time.
Thank you, Senator.
You're welcome.
And thank you for joining us for this special edition of Direct Connection. We're back Thursday with Your Money and Business, and then Friday on State Circle, the chairs of the Democratic and Republican parties. Thanks for joining us, and have a good night.
This program was made by MPT to serve all of our diverse communities.